Coming up on KUJH, a local man relives his experience at Super Bowl I.
And find out how local restaurants are gearing up for the big game this Sunday.
And a possible ethical dilemma with an application that helps with homework.
Live from the studio in Stauffer Flint at the University of Kansas, you're watching KUJH News.
Welcome back to KUJH. I'm Bella Line.
And I'm Kyle Mathis.
It has been a beautiful week so far, except for the unexpected snow. Let's head on over to Halen for a first look at what's to come in the weather. Halen?
Yes, definitely a surprise snow system that hit KU late last night. We were dealing with quite a bit of rain late last night, but then it quickly transitioned over into a very fat, wet snow. And of course, accumulations got pretty heavy out there. So far, we've seen right about between 1 to 2 inches, but you can see the snow is still covering much of campus out there. You can see also too, while we were in the 1 to 2 range, Kansas City saw closer to 3 inches and even some locally higher amounts as well. So definitely a weird system that went through late last night. You can see those snow reports there. But good news is that we are looking to warm things up over the next couple days and for this afternoon as well. You can see that snow cover on the satellite radar right now. But temperatures are already well above freezing. We're at 40 right now here in Lawrence, 38 in Kansas City, and 39 degrees in Topeka. And as mentioned before, we're only going to get warmer from here on out. Eventually going to be talking about those mid 40s for this afternoon, with seeing some more cloud cover beginning to filter in later this afternoon. But it is going to get windy as well, so more likely we're going to be feeling like those upper 30s for much of the afternoon. But a lot of that snow is going to melt probably by the end of the day, and we're still looking at a much more warmer weekend ahead for us and a great Super Bowl forecast as well. But we do have another active pattern ahead for next week, which we'll talk about coming up in your full look at weather. Back to you guys.
Thank you, Halen.
One Lawrence man relives his time as a former Chiefs commentator and how that led him to Super Bowl I.
KUJH's Marlon Martinez sat down with the legend, Tom Hedrick.
Yeah, that's right, Kyle. Being the only Super Bowl I broadcaster alive, Tom lived through many experiences and remembers his first big game, like if it was yesterday. Over six decades ago, a man by the name of Tom Hedrick at the call of a lifetime.
Hank Stram, our Chiefs coach, picked up the phone on a Monday and talked to Bill McPhail of CBS and said, look, my team is coming, I'm coming, I want a young announcer named Tommy Hedrick. He's really good, he's never been heard before, so I want you to put him someplace in a broadcast.
And with that, Hedrick was on his way to Super Bowl I.
Well, then it was not the Super Bowl. It was the AFL National Football League Championship game.
The former Chiefs play-by-play commentator was one among the first broadcasters at what has come to be known as simply as the big game.
I went out there, it was about an hour before the game, and I almost choked.
That feeling soon vanished when he heard this message from his broadcast partner.
Listen, if you weren't good, you wouldn't be here. So you're qualified.
His time in the broadcast booth confirmed his colleagues' assurances, netting Hedrick a lot of professional accolades.
Where I finally won the top sportscaster in Kansas, that validated me as a sportscaster.
Now, days before the big game, Hedrick has high hopes for the Kansas City Chiefs.
I think it's almost even. They're saying the Eagles by two. I wouldn't bet against the Chiefs.
And still calling him like he sees him, with Kansas broadcast legend Tom Hedrick. I'm Marlon Martinez, KUJH News. And at age 87, Hedrick continues to cheer on for the Chiefs, and he says he hopes for another Super Bowl win. Back to you guys.
Thanks, Marlon. Fans are counting down the days until Super Bowl Sunday, and Lawrence restaurants are preparing for a large turnout. KUJH's Catherine Galliani spoke with local restaurant owners about what they're cooking up for the big game.
Super Bowl Sunday is just about 72 hours away, and Lawrence restaurants are preparing for a flood of fans ready to eat and drink their way through the big game.
Because it's the Chiefs Super Bowl, it's going to be extremely busy. If it was a regular Super Bowl, maybe not so much, because nowadays everybody has big screen TVs, but now everybody wants to be in a group. So I anticipate being a lot of fans down here that want to be around other people that are enjoying it. Yes.
Restaurants willing to cater to these fans are counting on added revenue, and servers and bartenders brave enough to face the crowds are counting on big tips.
I'm expecting higher revenue. We have a expanded crew. Normally we'll have 6 or 8 people working down here, but we'll have 15 or 20 working down here
that live around here will definitely come in, so we do expect a higher revenue, higher tips all around.
Forecasters are calling for a warmer than usual day on Sunday, which means that restaurants are able to use their outdoor spaces to accommodate for the bigger crowds.
We're really well known for our patio space. Seats a lot. We have tables out there. We have ashtrays. We have a lot of good sunlight. So yeah, a lot of people, especially since it'll be nice on game day, a lot of people do anticipate watching the game out there. There's TV, and if it does cool down at night, we've got heaters out there too.
This is Catherine Galliani with KUJH News.
Restaurant owners encourage fans to get there early to beat the crowds.
A popular new artificial intelligence application is making content creation a lot easier. It's called ChatGPT, and it's also causing some moral dilemmas, especially on college campuses. KUJH's Sam Goldman explains.
The free-to-use AI application ChatGPT is helping students do their research and causing confusion about who's really doing the work.
ChatGPT launched last November and has since caught the attention of many universities and schools concerned with AI doing a student's work.
It's disconcerting. Until now, you had ways to figure out if students were plagiarizing. What is this?
KU French professor Bruce Hayes says the AI application may force educators to rethink traditional teaching methods.
We fixate on the paper. Maybe we need to think about other forms of to get students to do critical analysis and communication.
Students have also raised concerns about the unethical use of ChatGPT.
About the fact that people are able to have their entire essays like written for them, or that like if they start becoming dependent on it to be able to be creative and to come up with their own ideas, I do see that as a problem.
So how does it work? Simply type a prompt into the text box. For example, write a TV ad about the status of ChatGPT, and in a matter of seconds, it will do just that. KU student Sophia Lind says, to her surprise, some of her professors are embracing the new technology and encouraging students to use it in an ethical way.
One of my professors is actually writing the textbook with ChatGPT. It's not fully out yet, but yeah, it's my finance professor, and he's writing it with ChatGPT, so he sort of encourages it. But
while some see it as a helpful tool, others are concerned about the potential for it to be misused. Sam Goldman, reporting for KUJH News.
Still to come, a look at a new exhibit shining light on the history of Haskell.
And details on the Wakarusa Drive extension and its potential environmental harm to the wetlands.
Welcome back and good afternoon, Jayhawks. We had quite a bit of a snow system that moved in late last night. I was actually out reporting on KU campus. You can see those huge snowflakes quickly accumulating last night and left the roads pretty hazardous for late last night. But so far, we're seeing a lot of that snow beginning to melt as temperatures are finally getting well above freezing. We're still at about 40 degrees here in Lawrence, 43 in Wichita, 38 in Columbia, and 35 degrees in Omaha, Nebraska. So a little bit colder the further you go to the north, but we still got plenty of some warmer temperatures ahead for us for this afternoon. You can still see on that satellite those snow-covered areas there, but again, they're going to quickly be gone by this afternoon as we're still expecting temperatures to be in the mid-40s for this afternoon. But here's an overall look of the region so far. You can see that snow system that we had late last night still moving further out to the northeast of us with some little pockets of snow just to the northeast of us as well, but we still got a quiet pattern ahead for us for the next couple of days. We got a lot of sunshine still going to be in store for the week, and before we'll get into a little bit more of an active week later next week, which we'll talk about that in just a minute. But for tonight, you're going to want to bundle up. It's going to be a cold one. We still got temperatures dropping into those lower 20s as our lows for tonight, with those winds still blowing at about 10 to 15 miles per hour and gusts up to 25 miles per hour. So in reality, we're going to be feeling like those single digits possibly for this evening. So Yeah, can't stress enough, bundle up for tonight and tomorrow morning, but it is still going to be a little bit more of a chillier one as temperatures are going to struggle to get up into those upper 30s. But we are still going to enjoy plenty of some sunshine tomorrow and for the next several days as we continue to see temperatures warm up for the next several days. We're going to be talking about eventually the return of the 40s, 50s, possibly maybe even the 60s again, but more likely we're still going to be within the 50s going into the Super Bowl weekend, which is going to be a phenomenal forecast for here. Still well above average for this time of the year for us. But if you're in Lawrence or Kansas City, we're still going to be within the 50s for the most part, right around kickoff time. But if you're going to be in Glendale, Arizona, you're enjoying the 60s down there. And of course, the very dry air. So don't have to worry about that wind chill out there at all. And still, we're going to be remaining pretty dry for the next several days until once we get into Tuesday. For Valentine's Day, we are tracking a potential for a big rain system that might be moving in for much of Valentine's Day. So could see a washout for that, so make plans to bring some umbrellas. And even too, looking ahead into next Thursdays, we're keeping an eye on this disturbance that could bring the potential for maybe some snow, but it all depends on where that system is going to track. If it goes further to the north, we probably won't see much of anything, but if it stays on this current path right now with this model, we could be in for some round two of some snow. But for right now, enjoy the weather for this weekend. We've got those 50s still in store for the weekend and even going into the first half of next week as well. But that rain chance is still going to be there going into your Valentine's Day holiday. But that is all I have for this weather forecast. Back to you.
Thanks, Halen. The Watkins Museum of History debuted a new exhibit covering the history of Haskell Indian Nations University. Sophia Nash is here to tell us more about the event.
The exhibit is called From Then to Now, a student history of Haskell Indian Nations University. I spoke with Watkins curators who hope this exhibit will raise awareness of Haskell's history.
Well, so Watkins Museum knew we wanted to have this space available to tell stories of Haskell. And so what we knew was we couldn't be the people who are leading that story.
Within the exhibit, there are many different pieces of Haskell history, including this traditional headdress, a band uniform, and the school's original crest.
It took the two curators in partnership with Haskell's Cultural Center 1 year to gather research and get the exhibit ready for its debut in December.
Haskell Cultural Center in Watkins had lots of photographs. So that was, I also like photographs too, it's real nice, but I was trying to get as many three-dimensional things as possible. Which they didn't have as much, so that kind of helped narrow down the search.
Haskell's been in Lawrence since 1884. This exhibit showcases the different changes Haskell has gone through since its opening, while also including information that even Lawrence residents might not know.
One thing you might not know about Haskell is when it originally opened, it was called the Indian Industrial Training School.
From Then to Now exhibit will be displayed until the end of March. The Watkins Museum of History is open Tuesday through Saturday from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m.
For more information about the exhibit, check out Watkins' website and make sure to keep an eye out for an official Final Friday debut at the end of this month.
The Lawrence City Commission has voted to not move forward with funding the South Wakarusa Drive extension.
That South extension met with opposition from some environmental interests. Some of those opposed rallied at Haskell Indian Nations University. KUJH's Dana Nasser was there and has the details.
Saving the wetlands is a priority for Indigenous community members and environmental advocates alike in Lawrence. The Wakarusa Extension Project is part of Plan 2040, the city's long-term capital improvement plan.
It's a sort of a joint city-county issue. The county's asked us, would we provide funding for a road? We have previously expressed a disinterest in funding for some of the reasons expressed, particularly by the Indigenous people of Haskell, and it conflicts with Plan 2040, one of our plans that we try to adhere to.
Ever since the approval of Plan 2040, Indigenous community members have protested the extension, believing that road construction and a stronger connection between North and South Lawrence will have a major detrimental environmental impact on wildlife while also polluting the natural wetlands.
There comes a time where there's like respect for our non-human relatives that are living in the Wakarusa Valley and not just about human safety. By putting in these roads, we're going to pollute the downstream areas of the Wakarusa Valley, which includes the Haskell Wetlands, which has not been able to heal from the construction of the South Lawrence Trafficway. back in the 2015-2016.
The event, hosted by advocates on Thursday, served to inform community members about this potential environmental harm. City Commissioner Courtney Shipley touches on the extent of care for public opinion in Lawrence.
It is vital that they come and tell us, or that they give us email, phone calls. That is what we thrive on, and that is what we have built ourselves on. That is actually part of what makes Lawrence Lawrence, is that people will always come and tell us what they actually think.
City commissioners voted to deny funding for the south extension of Wakarusa on Tuesday, but are willing to fund $3.6 million for another road project, which has yet to be decided. This is Dana Nasser reporting for KUJH News.
Thanks, Dana.
We'll be right back after this break.
Where you go to college makes a statement about you. This place will become a part of you, your identity for life. The University of Kansas, a great place to be you.
Time is now ticking to get personal bests up on the board. Up next in sports, find out how KU's track and field team is preparing for some of their biggest meets of the season.
Welcome back to KUJH. A lot has been going on in the sports world, and locally and nationally, and obviously here in KU, there's been a lot of sports going on despite the Super Bowl taking place this past week. So with a Super Bowl matchup 3 days away in Glendale, Arizona, between the local Kansas City Chiefs and Philadelphia Eagles, there's still a lot happening in KU sports as winter sports continue to progress and spring sports commence starting out this week. To start off, Kansas men's basketball heads into a road matchup of Oklahoma on Saturday after they took down the fifth-ranked Texas Longhorns Monday night at Allen Fieldhouse 88-80. Despite just 2 points from redshirt junior Jalen Wilson, freshman Grady Dick scored 21 to lead KU to a much-needed conference victory. As the Jayhawks head into the second half of their Big 12 schedule, taking it one game at a time remains most important with still plenty of tough opponents lined up in their way.
We played really poor ball over the last 2 weeks, 3 weeks for the most part. And, you know, you look up and we're tied for the poorest we've ever started a league at 6-4 ever in the 20 years we've been here, and you're ranked ninth in the country. That just goes to show you how good the league is.
Regarding Kansas women's basketball, the Jayhawks defeated TCU last night 73-55 in a game KU led for the majority of the way. Led by junior Trayvon Prater's 19 points and a 13-point, 10-rebound performance from senior Tyana Jackson, Kansas outscored the Horned Frogs 15-8 in the first quarter and never looked back on their way to the 15th victory this season. After several tough losses over the last few games, the Jayhawks remain poised and prepared, knowing how important it is to stay grounded despite the close defeats.
You can't build momentum without winning the next game. And, you know, we've had one possession losses the last two games. And those sting. They all sting, but I think when you're right there and just don't make that final play. But it's important. I mean, we know that there's still a lot of ball left. You know, but we have to take advantage of each opportunity.
Kansas will next take on Texas Tech Saturday in Lubbock, with tip-off set for 2 p.m. Looking ahead for Kansas track and field, they'll compete in the Tyson Invitational in Fayetteville, Arkansas, and in the Tiger Paw Invitational in Clemson, South Carolina, which are both scheduled for tomorrow and Saturday. After successful outings in the Jayhawk Invitational and the Husker Invitational over the last 2 weeks, the Jayhawks look to keep the momentum going with their Big 12 championships under 2 weeks away. Now moving on to spring sports, softball begins their 2023 campaign today at 4 p.m. as they take on Long Beach State in the Candria Classic in Tucson, Arizona. Today's game will be the first of 5 games this weekend in which they will face North Carolina State and host team Arizona in addition to Long Beach State. The first home series for Kansas softball takes place March 10th in the Jayhawk Invitational. Rounding out KU sports, Kansas tennis is heading on the road to take on Arkansas at 3 p.m. tomorrow afternoon, and then we'll take on Memphis on Saturday morning in Fayetteville. First serve is set for 11 a.m. against the Tigers. And as for the Super Bowl, we'll have the full reaction during next week's show as the Chiefs look to win their second Super Bowl in 4 seasons Sunday night. Kickoff from State Farm Stadium is set for 5:30 p.m. Make sure to stay tuned to our social media accounts for all things sports throughout the week. So that's going to be a look at sports. We'll be right back after this break.
From adversity, we rose. We made history and became pioneers, voyagers, champions, Jayhawks. And when our chant rises, haunting and hallowed, Jayhawks are telling the world what's near. Victory.
Still to come, we'll find out why wetlands are crucial for the environment and how climate change is affecting them.
And there is still a blood shortage in the country. Find out what Kansas Athletics is doing to help.
Walking alone in a college town can be dangerous, no matter the time of day. Lawrence might seem like a small town, but there are still tons of crime that happens. You never know where and or when people are planning to attack, so it is better to be safe than sorry. Being by yourself is never the answer. That's why people should always walk within a buddy system. Having at least 3 people to walk with can help with getting home safer. Going out in a bigger group is definitely the way to go, so everyone can be assured they are safe. If walking home isn't an option, calling KU Safe Ride is the next best option, or ordering an Uber with your friends. Stay safe and always keep a buddy with you.
Welcome back. Concerns about climate change are a global issue. To that end, a local nature spot celebrated World Wetlands Day.
That's right, Kyle. I visited the Baker University Wetlands for that celebration and learned a lot about the conservation areas around us.
This outdoor spot is a favorite for people to hit the trail, enjoying a nature walk or bicycling. But for the Discovery Center's Education and Outreach Coordinator, Bluebird Taylor McCown, the wetlands are much more than just a pretty spot to enjoy the scenery.
Wetlands, they're just these really unique habitats. They're just as diverse as a rainforest is. They just support so much biodiversity.
Taylor McCown says climate change is a real concern, and she fears what continued change will mean for the many different species who depend on the wetlands for their survival.
And, you know, we're entering in a time when, you know, with the climate talk, these type of things are important for the environment all over the place. So I think it's very important that people realize that if we want to keep water on the land, beavers are an important part of that. And then, you know, the wetlands are also something that people should be aware of and start thinking about.
Central to its mission, the Baker University Wetlands Discovery Center works to educate the public about climate change and the importance of local residents doing their part to preserve this ecological system.
I grew up in Southern California, and 90% of our wetlands are just gone just because of development and all of that. And I went to school for environmental analysis and design and saw how our loss of wetlands really affected our habitat and understand how important the habitat is and what the impact of us keeping natural areas like this available to not just us but to the wildlife who live here, and making sure that we have species that maybe generations from now our grandchildren can see at some point.
By taking your waste to proper facilities, the Discovery Center hopes to preserve the wetlands during this uncertain time.
The Baker Wetlands Discovery Center plans to continue hosting educational events for all ages as it continues to work to combat climate change closer to home.
There has been a recent blood shortage locally, and the Community Blood Center is asking for donations. KUJH's Anna Ambrose has the story.
In the midst of a blood shortage locally, Kansas Athletics is stepping up to host a blood drive here on campus. The Red Cross and Community Blood Center says they need at least 750 units of blood daily to supply the 70 assigned counties in the state of Kansas. On January 27th, the FDA released a new proposed guideline for the LGBTQ community. This proposed guideline would allow people to donate blood regardless of gender or sexual orientation. The FDA says it might be at least another year before these rules change on the LGBTQ community being able to donate. The blood drive traveled to campus in hopes of getting more student donors. The Community Blood Center hopes to be back on campus in March to receive more donations. Reporting for KUJH, I'm Anna Ambrose.
We will keep you updated on when the Community Blood Center is back on campus.
All right, Kyle, I know you're a sports fanatic. What is the best collector's item that you own right now?
I think the best collector's item is definitely a signed football by the Chicago Bears 2007 Super Bowl runner-up team. They didn't win the Super Bowl, but that I bet it's worth a lot of money. I'll never sell it, though. But.
Well, that's incredible. Well, a piece of sports history is being auctioned off, a bottle of sand. You heard me right. A bottle of sand is being auctioned off for $100,000. But not just any bottle of sand, it's the sand that Tom Brady sat on while recording his second retirement announcement. The 8-ounce glass bottle is being sold on eBay by the user GadgetGS. GadgetGS claims to have collected the sand just hours after the announcement was posted to social media.
Thank you guys so much to every single one of you for supporting me, my family, my friends, my teammates.
But now there are several other auctioneers claim to also have sand from the spot. Their prices are anywhere from $10,000 to $33,000. For that kind of money, you could just buy your own trip to Miami and collect your own bottle of beach, in my opinion. I don't know about you guys. What do you think? A bottle of sand is being auctioned off. That's crazy.
Just think about what you could buy for $100,000. And you're buying a bottle of sand. I don't know how to feel about that one, but
yeah, it's crazy to me because you don't see that often. But it's one of those things that it's really cool. I mean, it's definitely a piece of history, right? I mean, Tom Brady. There's no one really else like him, but it's definitely a cool piece of history for sure.
Well, that's just crazy. So, Gus, update us a little bit about what we should expect for the Super Bowl and things coming up in sports.
Yeah.
I mean, bottle of sand. Who would have guessed? Is there anything else crazy going on in sports?
Right, who would have guessed, right? I would say, no, Super Bowl should be a great game. You look at two teams that I think are pretty evenly matched. You talk about, obviously, the Chiefs and what they've done all season. They've been probably the most dominant team in the AFC coming into it. And also, you have to think, too, you look at the Eagles, what they've been able to do. I mean, Kelce, Super Bowl's on the line, or the brothers on the line. There's just a lot going on, so it should be a great Super Bowl. And hopefully, we'll see. Maybe a victory for the Chiefs, and should be some fun times.
That's great. And, Halen, it looks like we're going to have some beautiful weather for Super Bowl Sunday. What else can we expect?
Well, be prepared for an active week. We're going to be looking at a washout for Valentine's Day and maybe another winter system. But, of course, just stay with us, and we'll track that going into next week.
That's crazy. That's all we have for now. Thank you for watching KUJH. Make sure to tune in next week for more.
At tv.ku.edu.